Clinical Pharmacology Department. And today we will start our module Clinical Pharmacology. First 5 minutes, I will make registrations, and after this, we will start our lecture. Accordingly to our, but for a good connection, I ask everybody to switch off microphones and camera. Okay? Okay.
Okay, but can you also send us the lectures, please?
So all lectures are available on site, university site.
Excuse me, doctor, we should open the video, the camera and the sound.
So, no, you just wait, because first minutes I will make registrations.
No, after, I mean.
And you have access to all lecture.
Uh-huh. Okay.
On university site, we have all lecture available. And I will write here code for lecture. So, accordingly to our plan, today it's central nervous system lecture, but I will start with introduction lecture. So, I will present a shortly version of these two lecture in today planning time. So, in this way, last lecture, when we'll have at 3 June, we will just discuss some general issue, okay? So, let's me to put our lecture. So, can you confirm it's a slide, it's available for you?
Yes,
professor, it's okay.
Okay.
Yes, everything is okay.
I will full screen make, it's okay?
Excellent.
Yes, professor.
Okay, super. So, let's to start our introduction in clinical pharmacology. Here you can see a summary of our lecture, but I will spend some time, not at all topics, but most important for my point of view. About the definitions, clinical pharmacology. Shortly, this is about the study of drugs in humans. It's a bridge between pharmacology and clinical medicine. So, oh, this is about connection. I can't make registration if I start present. For future, try to register in time on lecture, okay?
Okay.
It's available? Oh. So first 5 minutes I can spend for registrations, but after, I will not accept.
Doctor,
yes.
Students tell us that they send requests, but nobody accept them. Why? Technical problem?
I can. What you mean that
like
nobody?
Students tell me that they send requests, but nobody accept them. Maybe there is technical problem.
to give yes, because of technical problems. But
exactly, it's not their fault, you know.
Sometimes. I will yes. I will change state for in this situation, and everybody can accept his colleagues. Yes. For the future. Okay. So about the aim of clinical pharmacology. So the main aim is to study in human body all pharmacological effects, pharmacodynamics and pharmacokinetics. And in this situation, the main aims is optimization of existing medications and development of new medications. I will not spend time on history, but I just want to pay your attention that it's quite young discipline, starting with 1930 and in 1960 years was this discipline in already in university. And as example, you can see the Harry Gold and Walter model used this clinical first, we can say first clinical study, double blind design for study pharmacokinetics of cardiotonic glycosides, digoxin. And also Martini described use of placebo, control groups, stratification, and this method for clinical design in new drugs elaborations. Also, another point is legislation. I will not spend time on Moldavian legislation. For you will be very important to study local legislation. It depends on the country when you will develop your activity. It's very important to know everything about the legal state of drug domain. About pharmacovigilance, we will discuss also today because monitoring of drug safety, drug adverse reactions, it's very important, especially after thalidomide tragedy, when thousands of children was born with such kind of teratogenic effect, no legs, no hands. So this is thalidomide disaster consequences. And another consequences was to fortification of legislation in drug domain. And nowadays, drug domain is the most strange regulated domain. In the context of drug development, there is main two phases, preclinical development and clinical development. Of course, clinical pharmacology, it's about clinical development. So after study in rats, rabbits, monkey, in vitro study, when we have quite acceptable data about toxicity and tolerability, we must to extrapolate this data to human body. And after this, start clinical trials, phase one till phase four. Nowadays, legislation was changed and we discuss about phase zero, especially for new drugs, biological products with high risk. So the high risk medication must to start with clinical phase zero. When we start with one volunteer and after this we add second, and till we have enough number of for statistical data. So something about 10-12 volunteer, healthy volunteer. And only after this we switch to phase one, classical phase one, phase two, pre-marketing study phase three, and after we have post-marketing phase four. So a good clinical trials requires multidisciplinary personnel. So we must have a basic scientist, a clinical pharmacologist, clinical specialist in different domain, mathematics and statisticians. So it's quite a huge and a very time consumer and money consumer work. On this slide, you can see that from 10,000 compounds, only one can became a drug. And this process take something about 15 years. Nowadays, this process is more rapid, but even though in medium, we have we need 6-8 years for receive a new drugs. And of course, a lot of money. And I also want to specify some methods. So different, the gold standard in clinical trials is considered, of course, double-blind design, control design with randomized study. So this is the most, veridic data. Also, we must to take in account when we decide to study in human drugs, ethical aspects. So, based on Helsinki Declaration of Human Rights, of course, we must to protect the subject involved in clinical trials. And also, these aspects are very, very strong regulated around the world. United States also EMA is responsible for European Union, Japanese, so all countries around the world respect these standards. And in file for that are supply for admissions must to be included the general needed information. So it's information about the composition and the source of drug materials, everything about manufacturings, all data from a preclinical study, all data for existing clinical study already done. And of course, it's very important team that will develop the study trials. We need to involve very high professionals and training the person in study trials domain. So the same information you can see, but here we have a post-marketing surveillance phase four. And here we have a number of involving, So in phase one, something about 20 till 50. Phase two can be patient, hundreds patient, but phase three, pre-marketing, we need to involve thousands of patient in study. So this about in medium, I already told about 6 years in medium nowadays, and you can see phase one till 100 volunteer, phase two study efficacy and also safety profile, and some pharmacodynamics effect are used, the single blind design, are used double blind design also. Phase three, as I told, thousands of patients involved, especially for study safety profile of new drugs. And also gold standard, it's advisable to use double blind crossover randomized clinical trials. And after drugs is approved and it's available on the market, all health organization, WHO organization, have a special committee that give name of drugs. And usually this name, it's recognized around the world. International non-appropriate names or generics name. Practically, it's the same. And after patent expiring, everybody can, if follow regulations, can manufacturing these drugs under generics name and can give own commercial name. So drugs can have generic name, international non-appropriate name, and commercial name. First commercial name, usually it's brand name of drugs. For example, Alprazolam, it's generic name. International non-appropriate name, it's Alprazolam. But first Alprazolam, developed by Hoffmann La Roche, it's Xanax. So nowadays you have a lot of commercial name of Alprazolam, but Xanax is the first one. Another state of drugs on approval the stage is about the legal situation. Will be delivered from pharmacy without any prescription, doctor prescription. So it's OTC drug, over-the-counter drugs. It's prescription with prescription, or it's about controlled substances. So also when drugs is authorized, drugs receive this special category of drugs. Another situation also, it's how to keep drugs. It's very important. And also in this leaflet, we have practical all information of drugs, product characteristic of drugs contain everything about drugs that it's available on on the market. But I can just say that can be differences. So for example, one drugs are contraindicated till 2 years old. For example, loperamide. One manufacturer contraindicated these drugs till 2 years old. Another manufacturer contraindicated these drugs till 5 years old. And also in Moldova can be drug regulatory authorities in Moldova can say, okay, loperamide we will put on our market, but we will not agree with contraindication till 5 years. We will contraindicate it, we will register these drugs, but with contraindication till 2 years old. So there is some situation when manufacturer proposed, but drug regulatory agency after commissions discuss how to put on the market with prescription or without prescription and with some maybe with some caution or some modification in safety profile or in contraindications. Of course, control substances have a special legislation, and this is, for example, in the United States was established in 1970 years. In Moldavian legislation also, it's quite good regulated stupefiant drugs. So here you can see example of generic and commercial names, Amoxil. So this is commercial name, amoxicillin, it's generic name or international non-appropriate name. Amoxicillin, Ritiopharm. So also it's commercial name because the non-appropriate international non-appropriate name, but also in the name of drugs, we have part of name of companies that develop these drugs. Ranitec, so it's commercial name of ranitidine active ingredients. It's very important and it's prohibited to not indicate the international non-appropriate name for avoiding misunderstanding. So Flagyl, it's metronidazole. Triconazole, it's metronidazole. Tricopol, it's metronidazole. So we have a lot of commercial name of this principal active ingredients. And also, there is a lot of factors that can influence response to drugs. And a good doctor must take in account practical all factors that can influence response. So we have factors, drugs factors, patient factors, and of course, environmental factors. For example, about patient variability. We need to take in account, of course, and pharmacogenetics profile of a patient, comorbidities, age, concomitant drug administrations, gender, to understand about how this patient will follow treatment, so compliance. Of course, there is some drugs and some route of administration that patient cannot be administered. For example, if this is also its connection between compliance and route of administration. Some person will not administered suppositorium rectalium, for example. We have low bioavailability. If we have bioavailability lower than 20%, it's not practical need to develop the oral formulations. So in this situation, we will perform, we will elaborate powder for injection, solution for injection, but not oral formulations. Also, we need to take in account some food habits, beverage, timing, like chronopharmacology, we need to take in account. And of course, such factors as smoking and narcotics and things like this that can influence patient response. From drugs variability, we will take in account, of course, pharmacokinetics and pharmacodynamics properties of drugs. And taking in account this, we will select correct dose, correct route of administration. So we will take in account the possibility of drug-drug interaction, especially significant drug interaction for drugs with narrow therapeutic index. So all of this thing will be taken in account. And of course, for avoiding side adverse reaction, for maintaining correlation between efficacy and risk in a good balance. And here you can see definition of adverse drug reactions recognized around the world because it's World Health Organization's definitions. Any noxious, unintended, undesirable effect of a drugs which can occur, it's very important a dose, therapeutical dose that are used for prophylaxis, for diagnosis, for therapy, excluding therapeutical mistakes. And this drug adverse reaction can happen, effect intentional or accidental. So in this situation, in case when we have overdose, this is exception and we cannot consider it adverse drug reactions. So this is very important to understand that adverse drug reaction happened at dose used for prophylaxis, diagnosis, and therapy. And he will not include overdose, doesn't matter. It's intentional or accidental overdose, drug abuse. So this is not included in this category. Of course, our main goals is to help our patients and not to harm. So first, do not harm. It is a good remedy sometimes to use nothing. Hippocrates, it's very simple and very important to keep in mind this, because we have a very, very high incidence of adverse drug reactions, especially severe drug adverse reactions. And I just want to give you international classification. This classification we have in our books accordingly to our programs, classification accordingly to severity. And I will give international classification ABCD. Unpredictable. So these are A classification, type A from augmentation. Are so this classification of adverse reaction ABC augmented, bizarre, chronic, continuous administrations, delay, ending of use, and the last year was included, and the failure of treatment efficacy. So, if to start with type A, what that means? So, type A are pharmacological depending, so based on mechanism of action. And because of this, it's are predictable, happen quite often, till 75-80% of drug adverse reaction are pharmacological depending. And of course, it's not difficult to manage this drug adverse reaction. So we can predict, and we can manage just for with dose adjustment. For example, bleeding after warfarin heparin administrations, bradycardia after beta blockers administrations, hypoglycemia after anti-diabetics administrations. So it's clear. Second, we have type B, bizarre, unpredictable, are not dose related, and practical we can make a forecast for this kind of drug adverse reactions. These drug adverse reactions are study a lot by such kind of discipline like post-marketing study, pharmaco-epidemiological study are preoccupied to study this kind of drug adverse reactions. So can be developed based on immunological reactions like idiosyncratic allergical reactions. So hypersensibility and genetic predispositions. It's difficult to predict, but we have hopefully incidence, it's not high, it's something about 10-15%, but it's high mortality. So unpredictable, bizarre, unpredictable. Next, chronic continuous administrations. Especially when we have drugs that have capacity to accumulate in the body. And also, for example, uncontrolled prolonged use of non-steroid anti-inflammatory drugs, now today topics, peripheral analgesic drugs, can develop interstitial nephritis, papillary sclerosis, necrosis. So as example. But also, if we know very well pharmacokinetics and pharmacodynamics profile, especially pharmacokinetics, we can predict such kind of adverse reactions. Type D, delayed. So this type of adverse reaction will appear after some time. So is when we study correlation between dose drug administration and effect, here we have a problems because administration of drugs can be today, but effect will be in months or in years. For example, thalidomide tragedy. Pregnant woman receive, but effect will appear in a child. So correlation in generation, mother and children. Also, another good example for a delay when appear in 1960 contraception, oral hormonal oral contraceptions, and only after 15-16 years was developed that a huge number of girls developed cancer. And when was analyzed correlation between what is common for this category of patient, that mother receive contraceptions, and after this formulation of this for this proposal was changed and improved, and nowadays contraceptive drugs are more safe than first generation of hormonal contraceptions. Mutagenic, cancerogenic effect also it's not simple to predict and to have on preclinical study in animals. We can just to receive some information, but we haven't 100% of data. So another example of delay, we can give this example, antipsychotic drugs that are used for long term administration for treat schizophrenic patients and tardive dyskinesis. After month of administration can appear this. Also we can predict taking in account mechanism of action, especially mechanism of action and some pharmacokinetics property. Type E, end of use. Withdrawal syndrome, so classical rebound and withdrawal syndrome. We can give example of hypnotic drug, of sedative, anxiolytic drugs, opioid analgesic drugs. We will develop these phenomena. And the last one that was included, I think something about 5 years ago, failure of treatment. So if we haven't result was taking decision to include as adverse reactions for identify and to find causes what happened. We have falsification, we have not a good quality of drugs, or we haven't enough active ingredients, or maybe quality of active ingredients is not good. So for have a answer, this kind of effect also should be studied. So pharmacovigilance, this is science that are focused on study of drug adverse reaction. So study and activities related to detection, assessment, understanding, and prevention of adverse effect from one hand. And for another hand, we have also measurements, feedback. And the most not dangerous, the severe feedback is withdrawal from the market. Another measurement can be just modification in the indications. We will make indication more less indication. We can increase cautions and contraindications. For example, drugs that was withdrawn from the market, now topics, today topics, non-steroid anti-inflammatory drugs. So was developed second group, selective, that inhibit COX. Only COX-2, yes, COXIBs, and Rofecoxib was put on the market, prescribed very often, and after this, a lot of signals, cardiovascular problems and death, and Vioxx was commercial name, first commercial name of Rofecoxib was withdrawn from the market. And Nimesulid, another medication from this group, a little bit later, but also was stop production authorization for 1 year. And EMA, European Medicine Agency, re-evaluated safety profile of Nimesulid. And in this situation, Nimesulid was kept on the market, but with changing indication and contraindication. Safety profile was changed. And if administered drugs correctly, accordingly to instruction, so we can increase safety profile of drugs. So information generated for this activity is very useful for education on for official regulations to take correct decision for procurements, which kind of drugs to procure. So we will try to procure the most efficient, safe, and at the reasonable prices. So this is the main indicators for ensuring rational and safety drug administrations. So activities that involve pharmacovigilance. As I mentioned, post-marketing surveillance can be a post-marketing clinical study. Dissemination of adverse drug reaction data. So around the world, we have in Uppsala, in Sweden, we have a WHO center that are collected the drug adverse reaction around the world. And after this are distributed, and the whole country have access to this database. And as I told, as measurement, we can find changing in labeling, in medicine indications. So indicate a restriction of indication or withdrawal, the most severe are withdrawal of the drug from the market. And all these methods include study, clinical study, post-approval, spontaneous case report. So this is the most simple and efficient collecting of drug adverse reactions through these spontaneous case reports around the world. And also can be post-marketing study, case reports, and also in country like China, Japan are computerized data collections. I told already that in Uppsala, Sweden, we have international collaborated center for collecting and analyzing data. Here I have for India, especially for my group from Indian students, I put this information because in India also it's a very, very good and efficient center of collecting drug adverse reaction. And I was working in the WHO team with Shanti Paul, main expert of WHO from India. So let's go ahead to another concept, what it's so important to study safety profile for have the most efficient and safe medications. And based on this, WHO organization elaborate annually, starting with 1977, and revised and approved own essential medicine list. And this list usually is revised one time in 2 years. So definition of essential medicine. So these are medicine that are available and satisfy the priority healthcare needs of all population, and must to be available anytime. So we can understand this importance nowadays, especially in pandemic condition, when not medication but simple methods of protection became a problem, like mask and simple coat for just for one time using, yes, became a problem. Disinfectants, antiseptics, and we can understand that this is a national problems, country, so it's huge problems, and it's better to have own, which country, to build their own manufacturing of the main essential medications and the main essential device. So we will take in account for drugs that are included in this model list, to have a correct drugs with a balanced efficacy and safety profile, to be in appropriate formulations, to select appropriate dose and duration of administration, to keep in mind all contraindication, also all information about drugs, how to correctly keep these drugs, and to be sure that patient will follow, will be adherent to this treatment, so patient compliance. Many factors can influence use of medicine, and it's impossible to take in account all of them, but we must to keep in mind the main factors that can influence. And already I discussed about patient variability, doctors, and especially drugs variability. And WHO developed some strategy for improvement of rational use of drugs. Educational. So educational strategy is very important. Starting with education in school, especially for us in from university, and continuous education, and health provider and consumers must to be quite educated. Managerial strategies are also very important. Elaboration and to have guide for clinical practices, to have a guides for how to develop, how to manufacture, how to distribute drugs, how to use correctly drugs. Economics also, it's about collaboration between institutions, and to take in account the drugs, it's not only for business, it's mostly to take in account not only for profit, but in long term, it's the main profit of country, it's health citizen in the country. And the regulatory, restrict choice, and to have a good legislation, and respect this legislation for have a good control. As I told, drug domain is the most regulated domain around the world. And I want to present you this guide to good prescribers. It's available on our site. And please, if you will follow this instruction, you will be able to have a good selection of drugs for our practical topics, because in 10 days we must revise all theoretical aspects, to add a lot of clinical details, and to perform patient FISHA. Patient FISHA, we will analyze treatment that already patient received, and after this you will build your own prescription based on good correct diagnosis. You will specify therapeutic objectives, and after this you make analysis of available drugs that can be used for achieving concrete therapeutical purposes. You will choose drugs taking in account efficacy, safety profile, acceptability or suitability, and of course prices. So based on all these criteria, you will select your own P drug, personal drugs. So personal drugs selection. These four criteria must be taken into account: efficacy, safety, suitability, and cost. Of course, in these 10 days, we will practically not discuss about cost. We will discuss mostly about efficacy, safety, and suitability for concrete patient, for concrete category of patient, especially pregnant women, elderly, pediatric population. So we'll discuss about this for increasing compliance and good prescriptions. But when we discuss about drug administration on the country level, Ministry of Health, about director of hospital, of course, the cost of drugs, it's very, very important to know how to manage the money correctly. Because of this, so cost treatment is discussed later in our course. We will discuss about safety profile of drugs, efficacy, and suitability or acceptability. Why it's very important to regulate? It's very important to regulate for restrict, for limit drug abuse and inappropriate use of drugs. So here you have some reference, and also I advised you to use for clinical pharmacology Katsung. You can use leaping codes. You can use also Gilman and Goodman. And this guide to good prescription to be your Bible, like a Bible to study how to manage. And on a practical seminar, we will have a lot of example how to do concrete, how to do this task. And now let's me to switch to central nervous system drugs. If somebody want to register, I can do it now. So next. Next drugs I will very shortly give you, because lecture is available and you'll have possibility to study from it. Central nervous system. So it's good, you can see. Students, it's okay?
No, we see enough.
Okay. So tomorrow we'll have central nervous system acting drugs, and it's a huge topics, but on today lecture we have some topics on lecture and some topics on seminars. But on our final test are included all of them. And because of this, I will pay an attention just on some information that are practical importance and are included in your test. So about hypnotic drugs, average sleep needs by age. So it's very important to understand how we need to have normal time for rest. Starting with newborns till 18 hours in the first 2 months. To eat and sleep, nothing more. After this, till 12 years, we have need till 11 hours for sleeping. Nowadays, teenagers sleep 11 hours? Oh, of course not. Adolescents sleep 9 hours. And this is very important.
Doctor, we can't see anything.
You can see nothing?
Yes.
Yes, yes. What?
We can't see.
Now?
No.
Still no. No? I will. But okay, let's once again to include lecture. You hearing me?
Yes, we hear.
Okay. Because I want to give you just some classification. Accordingly to our program. Pum, 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 pum.
Yeah, we'll see.
Now it's okay?
Yes, perfect.
Yes. Okay. So
last time we slept 9 hours maybe when we had 9 years.
When we discuss about average sleep needs by age, it's very important because during when we sleep, like computer, when we put in for charging. The same it's sleep for our brain, for everything. Synthesis of main hormones, memory consolidation, energy, so everything. And you can see a lot of systems that are involved in sleep control. So GABAergic system, serotoninergic system, parasympathetic, sympathetic are involved. And because of this, we have a lot of group of drugs that influence these systems. So this is old classification of hypnotic drugs, and you can see starting with 80-60 chloralhydrate was used for this purposes, and in 60 appear benzodiazepines. I already told about first benzodiazepine thalidomide that are used as anxiolytics, anti-vomiting drugs, but nowadays benzodiazepines have a better safety profile, of course. Yes. It's okay? Oh, okay. Thank you. Thank you. So, and because of this, we have quite a huge number of drugs that can influence sleep installations. So barbiturates, benzodiazepine, non-benzodiazepine derivatives like zopiclone, zolpidem, aliphatic drugs, chloralhydrates, the most old drugs, GABA derivatives, sedative drugs, neuroleptics, antihistaminic drugs, especially first generation, H1, yes, that penetrate blood-brain barriers. Melatonin, antidepressant from tricycle, antidepressant like amitriptyline, and here you can see dose response for two different groups. We have drugs group A and drugs group B. What we can see here, if we will increase dose from drug A, we can go to coma and death. And this is characteristic for which kind of drugs? Hypnoinductors or hypnocoercive drugs. So based on this dose response, we have therapeutical classification of hypnotic drugs. So hypnoinductors and hypnocoercive drugs. So you can take a look. Hypnoinductors, benzodiazepine. On this slide here, which of them will be hypnoinductors? Drug B or drug A? Benzodiazepine. Hypnoinductors will not produce huge dose response, coma and death, and will not influence sleep structure. So hypnoinductors have a selective influence on central nervous system through benzodiazepine receptors, GABAergic complex, yes, allosteric mechanism of action. And this inhibition, it's not dose depending. Hypnotic effect is more evident in insomnia. And we have main effects: sedative, anxiolytics, hypnotic, anticonvulsive, muscle relaxation, and negative retrograde amnesia. So this is main characteristic for hypnoinductors like benzodiazepine derivatives, antagonist flumazenil. Also, hypnoinductors are non-benzodiazepinic derivatives like zolpidem, zaleplone, zopiclone. No decreased period of paradoxal sleep, so practical not influence sleep structure, and of course will not develop, not produce withdrawal effect. Here also we can mention sedative drugs. So sedative drugs, we can mention here low dose of benzodiazepine, very low dose of barbiturates, bromides, and of course plants. Like we can mention passiflora, we can mention valeriana officinalis. From antidepressant, we mention amitriptyline and melatonin. So these drugs are hypnoinductors. And main characteristic we already mentioned. So this group have a low influence on sleep structure. And because of this, will develop the soft safety profile. Hypnocoercive drugs. So the main drugs from this group is barbiturates. Also, aliphatic derivatives like chloralhydrate, bromizoval, old drugs, practical, are not used nowadays. Also, piperidine-dinone, we have here metoprolol, from kinazolone, metaclavone, and drugs that you know and it's used, diphenhydramine, from antihistaminic H1 first generation. Because of penetration blood-brain barrier, we have central nervous system effects. So for hypnocoercive drugs, characteristic non-selective inhibition of central nervous system. And this inhibition is dose-depending: sedation, sleep, anesthesia, coma, and death. So it's dose-depending. 3 grams of barbiturates can develop death. And unfortunately, quite often it's used for suicidal purposes. Wake up from sleeping is more difficult, so post-acting syndrome. And because of this safety profile, this group as hypnotic drugs practically was replaced by benzodiazepine. Also, the aliphatic derivatives also practical are not used nowadays. And for diphenhydramine, withdrawal effect is expressive in in patient, especially when we have high therapeutical dose. Another aspect that you must to keep in mind, it's about pharmacokinetic profiles. It's about onset of action, duration of action, for selecting correctly. So, hypnotic with short duration of action and short sleep instillation. So we have short, rapid onset of action. And you can see in this group from different, we have benzodiazepine, we have here non-benzodiazepine derivatives, we have here barbiturates. And also, just in test, you must to select correctly based on this data. So just keep in mind that oxazepam, midazolam, triazolam, temazepam are benzodiazepines with short duration of action in medium 3-4 hours, 2 till 5, and sleep instillation, one set of action, 15 minutes. Intermediate instillation, something about half of hour. And here we have benzodiazepine, nitrazepam, flunitrazepam. Also we have from barbiturates, amobarbital. And here we have H1 antihistaminic drug, diphenhydramine. And long duration from benzodiazepine derivatives, flurazepam, diazepam, and phenobarbital from barbiturates. So the same information, but separate group. Benzodiazepine, barbiturates, and you can take a look. Non-benzodiazepine derivatives, zolpidem, zaleplon, zopiclone, only short acting. Benzodiazepine and barbiturates, we have and short and intermediate and long acting drugs. I will not spend a lot of time on characteristic. You'll study it by themselves characteristic. I only want to mention that non-benzodiazepine derivatives are very widely prescribed, are indicated to treat insomnia, especially when we have problem with sleep instillation. And you can see here for zolpidem available dose, 6.25 and 12.5 milligram. And also, what it's important, duration of administration. Zolpidem, zaleplon, we can use 7-10 days. And for zaleplon, Food and Drug Administration's approved for 1 month administration, even though we must to take care about long duration of administrations. In medium, it's 2 weeks administration maximum, 7 till 10 days. So, of course, it's a good safety profile of non-benzodiazepine. Even though we have some side adverse reaction, we need to take in account this safety profile. It's more better than safety profile of barbiturates or in comparison with benzodiazepine also. About antihistaminic derivatives, classical antihistaminic derivatives quite often are used for this purposes, like hypnoinductors, like sedative drugs, potentiate action of analgesic drugs, have a quite good safety profile and less risk of tolerance and drug dependence. So clinical use of these drugs to treat anxiety disorder, to treat insomnia, sedation before or during medical and surgical procedures, for treatment as anti-epileptic drugs, anesthesia, potentiated of analgesia, for control of ethanol or sedative hypnotic withdrawal states, as muscle relaxation, also it's administrated and in psychiatric field also can use these drugs. So main indication of sedative hypnotics, anxiety state, sleep problems, and also other. And for treatment as anxiolytic drugs, we have secondary anxiety state, we have generalized anxiety disorder, panic disorder, acute anxiety state, and panic attacks. For benzodiazepine, for these proposes, especially main drugs is alprazolam, because it's anxiolytics, anhypnotics, and antidepressive drugs. On this slide, you can see different drugs and the main administration, and also dose depending. Main, for example, alprazolam can be used, as I mentioned, as sedative, as hypnotics, as anxiolytics, as antidepressant drugs. For zaleplon, zolpidem, only as hypnotics drugs, for comparison. So in conclusion, sleep disorders are very complex problems, and we must to make an account causes of insomnia to try to administer drugs as a last chance, to be very careful in drug selection, and of course taking account that barbiturates and benzodiazepine change sleep structure, but even though barbiturates have a more severe influence and more severe side adverse reaction. Non-benzodiazepine derivatives are more safe, minimum next day effects, but most are approved for short-term use for sleep, for improved sleep, sleep installations. So about general anticonvulsive and drugs, I will mention that we have symptomatic anticonvulsive and drugs, we have specific anti-seizure drugs, anti-Parkinsonian drugs, and central mu relaxants. So for symptomatic anticonvulsive and drugs, keep in mind benzodiazepine, barbiturates, aliphatic derivatives like chloralhydrate, local anesthetics like lidocaine, but also we must to keep in account that lidocaine by themselves, in case of accidental intravascular penetration, especially when in dentistry practices, can develop convulsion. So anticonvulsive and drugs lidocaine can produce convulsion in case of overdose, especially in oral cavity region, in person, in patients that have a predisposition to epilepsy. So it's very important to keep in mind such kind of detail. In this situation, it's advisable for persons that use lidocaine for infiltrative anesthesia in dentistry practices to have diazepam in available as antidote in this situation. GABA derivatives, oxybat, neuroleptics like chlorpromazine, droperidol, peripheric mu relaxant like succinylcholine, and magnesium sulfate. Here we have classification of central mu relaxant, also practical the same drugs, but we have add here carbamates and from Varia group like tolperizone, tizaridine, drugs that are have this property. And from anti-seizure drugs, anti-epileptic drugs, you have very good information in our books, in Harkevich, in Leaping Codes, in Katsung, all this group based on how to select. It depend of seizure type. And we have drug of first choice and alternative drugs. Revise this material, you pass at the third level very practical, quite enough material, but I'm interested now how to select correctly drugs in status epilepticus. because in our 1 year ago in one hospital, patient for in status epilepticus received timonial retard. That means timonial retard. This is carbamazepine in tablets and nothing more. And of course, patient died. So status epilepticus, it's a life-threatening conditions, and we must to react quickly. It's emergency conditions, and we need to administer intravenous administrations, not tablets. So selection drugs and way of administration, it's very, very, very important. So by classification by chemical structure, not a problem. You can take in account this, but more important to revise a mechanism of action and to keep in mind first line administration and alternative medications. Safety profile of this kind of drugs. So for phenytoin, you can see on this slide that we have gum hypertrophy, gingival hyperplasia. Not often, but happened such kind of drug adverse reaction. And also this patient go to dentistry. And doctor start to treat, but if causes is not clear, result will be zero. In this situation, we must withdraw drugs. So you can see for phenytoin, we have quite heavy safety profile. But drugs must be administered for long term of administrations. So carbamazepine, I told you about administration of these drugs in case of status epilepticus, when we have available only tablets, ordinary tablets and timonial retard, or tegretol, so the same carbamazepine in prolongated formulations. So important how to select correct drugs depend on concrete which type of seizure we have. So on this slide I select for you treatment of epilepsy, and pay attention because these are principles how to select and what to take in account when we start to treat epilepsy. Aim of treatment, initiation of treatment, it's very important to keep in mind that it's better to start with monotherapy, to start with a low therapeutical dose, to increase slowly dose, and if we need to switch to another medication, we will switch gradually. And only in situation when we can't solve, we will add and make an association of more than one drug. So we will switch to alternative medication and add the group for alternative medications. So for status epilepticus, goal of treatment, rapid termination of seizure activity. So for this goal, it's impossible to achieve with timonial retard. So is tablet administration, prompt treatment with very effective drugs and available for intravenous administration. So this is goal of treatment. And after goal of treatment, we go to and analyze drugs that can respond to this goal. Of course, diazepam. We have diazepam injection, 2 mg/min, fractional dose it's administered, and if not help, we can't use phenobarbital, also intravenous, can use and intramuscularly. We can use, if we haven't or not help phenobarbital, phenytoin also, intravenous administration. And we will every 10 minutes administer it till seizure will not stop. If will not help nothing, we go to supportive measurement to intensive care department, because this is a life-threatening situations. And also we must to take in account the drug interaction when we administered anti-epileptical drugs. And the anti-Parkinsonian drugs, you will study by themselves. And now these students questions because I must to go to another seminar and after this to state exam. Questions, please. So, did you find lecture? If some of you have a problem with how to find lecture, discuss tomorrow with your teachers, okay? Okay, okay. Good luck. Good luck. Bye.
Thank you, doctor.
Bye-bye.